Praise God. We always have this question going on in our mind that Lord, I'm praying so much, I'm doing so much, and yet Lord, I do not experience that life that you came to give me, life in abundance. So in these 2 days that God has given us, praise God, is going to give us some answers. How we can live that life of abundance, because Jesus said the thief comes to what? Steal, kill and destroy, but I have come to give you life in abundance. Now, any person who wants to walk in abundance, there are 8 steps which we have studied before. It's just a revision. Praise God. On revision, let me see how many of you can remember. I'll give you the first clue. The word produces thoughts. Complete the following. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Please write down before we start from the screen. First write down. The first step. Word produces thoughts. Thoughts produces. Anybody? Feelings and emotions. Feelings and emotions produces. Very good decisions. Decisions produces. Actions. Action produces. Habits. And habits produces character. And it is the character that leads to my destination. So if the word is, don't write that. If the word that you have received is godly, then it will produce what? Godly thoughts. Godly thoughts will produce what? Godly feelings, godly emotions. So that will lead you to where? Godly decisions. Godly decisions will lead you to what? Godly actions. Godly actions will lead you to what? Godly habits. Because you will repeat those actions again and again and develop it into a habit. That godly habit will develop in you a new godly nature, behavior, character. Praise God. So if any person seated here is experiencing that some areas of my life, my character is not according to God's word, then how do you change it? The question you should ask, to reach to this destination of my character, how did I develop this? How did I get this habit from? From where did this habit come from? And if this habit came, what led into that action? And if that action came, why did I take that action for the decision? How did I reach to this decision? To get this decision, what kind of emotions came into my mind? And if I got this ungodly emotions, how did I get them? From where did those thoughts come? And if I got those thoughts, how did I get those thoughts? What words did I receive to reach to that destination? Praise the Lord. Put the first slide, brother. Praise the Lord. So the first thing that you must remember is that words frame our thinking. You'll agree with me that many of you who have been coming from a long time listening to the word of God, and not only listening for those 2 days, but after that, when the DVD or the CD has been given and you are listening and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing the word of God, you have seen that your way of thinking has changed. And when the way of thinking has changed, you went through the whole process, and now you find that the nature and your character has changed. And praise be to God, the level to which your character has changed, the level to which the proportion to which your character has changed is the proportion to that abundant life that you are experiencing in your life. Might be you have come here, and might be you wrote the notes, might be you prayed, might be the preacher laid hands on you, he did everything, but you have not yet received that word in your heart. Praise be to God, your life will still remain the same. Hallelujah. So when we come to God and we say, Lord, I want to have an abundant life, the first thing he will say is, surely you can have an abundant life, but to experience that abundant life, you will have to follow instructions from the Bible. He will always give you instructions. And those who follow his instructions are the ones who experience that abundant life. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The first thing that you need as a farmer to receive the harvest, your character is your harvest. Praise God. You want to reach, you want to experience that abundant life, which is your harvest. Before you can reach that, there is going to be a need of a seed. Praise the Lord. So the seed is God's incorruptible word. And this word has to enter your heart. Praise God. This word enters your heart through your ear gate and produces the harvest. Now the Bible teaches us four steps how the word of God enters our heart. Can anybody remember? We studied that as well. I'll give you a clue. Let the word not depart from your heart. For out of the heart flows issues of life. Do you remember that? Yes. Okay, let's go for a revision again. Proverbs chapter 4. I think sometimes revision is better. Hello? Yes. Because let me tell you, this is the basic. And if you miss this, you have missed it all. Hallelujah. Okay, Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20. Charso bees. Don't forget that. In Bombay we say charso bees. When you say charso bees, means he's doing all kinds of wrong things. But in the Bible, Proverbs charso bees teaches you the right things. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The first thing he says, my son, what? Now let's study the word attend. What's the meaning of the word attend? A nurse attends to the patient. It's never said in English, a mother attends the child in the hospital. Nobody will say the mother attends to that child. But the nurse attends the patient. Why is it said the mother also is in the hospital looking after the patient, her child, but the word attend comes only to the nurse? Why? Because the nurse comes at a regular interval, comes and checks and rechecks the patient attentively and records everything in a file. Have you seen that? Yes. And then in the evening when the doctor comes, the doctor will only ask the nurse, give me the file. He doesn't ask the nurse anything. He only goes through the record of the whole day, what all changes have taken place, and he knows the condition of the patient, right? That's recording is called attentive. Praise God. Have you seen this happens in Bombay? Anybody from Bombay will agree with me? Children in Bombay, when they are studying, they have the TV on and they do their homework as well. Never seen that here? It's in India. Praise God. Now the child is watching the TV program and the child is also doing the homework. Now is the attention 100% on the TV or on the homework? Or is it divided? Now in the same way, God is asking you, when you are looking at my word, Are you attentive 100% or are you also looking at your symptoms? Are you also looking at your circumstances? Are you also looking at your problems? Are you looking at those things around you? So are you 100% attentive to God's word, or is your attention divided? If it is 100%, how many of us qualify in that? Praise God.
Hello?
Are you with me, please?
Yes.
The second thing it says, only those who are attentive to God's word, he says, incline your ears to my saying. The word incline means to bend. In other words, he's saying, I want you to submit to my word. I want you to take my word to rule over your life. Have you heard the word submission? Wives submit to your husband. What is submission? Submission simply means that I have a desire, I have a mission, but I cancel my mission and I get under another person's mission is called submission. Are you with me? Praise God. So in other words, he's saying, you have your own thoughts, you have your own desires, you got all those things and things going around you. But now when you have paid attention to God's word, no matter what's going around, you are saying, I cancel my mission and I'm ready to get under God's mission. That's inclining your ears to his saying. Praise the Lord. The third thing he says, keep them what? Keep them in the midst of your heart. Now many people believe. Many people believe it means to take some scriptures and stick them onto the wall so that it's right before your eyes. Praise God. Is it possible for a person who has got a scripture which says, by the stripes of Jesus I am healed. Okay, by the stripes of Jesus, you were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. It's right there with bold, colored, a scripture right before your eyes. You can see it. But with the inner eye, is still thinking of what the doctor said. Possible.
Come on,
possible. The person can still look at that scripture and still be worried. Possible. The person can still look at the scripture and cry tears of sorrow. So in other words, he's saying, let them not keep them in the midst of your eyes, means he's not saying the scripture that you see in the Bible. He's saying on that scripture, you make those images in your inner eye. Just as when the doctor said, listen, you got a bad report and nothing can be done. When the doctor says this one line, the person takes that line and begins to imagine, what about my husband? What about my children? What are they going to do? And all those things. Now why are you thinking all those things? You are thinking all those things because of that word you received from the doctor. So in other words, the insecurity of the future is before your eyes. In the same way, when you have the word of God, now you are imagining the goodness of the Lord before it can be manifested, is what you are keeping before your eyes. Do you understand? Now if you do step number one and step number two, then only you can reach the step number three, that these what God has promised you, you can visualize, you can imagine, and you can make an image in your inner eyes and believe for those things. Praise God. When step number one, two, and three takes place, that has entered your heart. That's the time the person is actually pregnant with that word. Hallelujah. When you come for a meeting like this and you listen to God's word and you see the healings and the demonstration of God's power and the Spirit of God working, you are built up and it has entered your heart and you have come out with faith. Praise God. Now, When this has been planted in your heart, the devil's job is to uproot what has been planted in your heart. And that's why he says what? What's the fourth one? Let it not. It's not there. Let them not depart from your eyes. And then fourth one. Give them. Now please understand, when you have a word of God in your heart and you allow your eye gate, your ear gate, your mouth gate, which are most vital gates, if you don't scan them, if you are not vigilant, then the things that will enter your eye gate, ear gate, and mouth gate will open the door for uprooting what's planted in your heart. Because what you see can go inside your heart and uproot that faith that is in your heart. Praise God. Hallelujah. And that's why he says, keep them in the midst of your heart. It means what? You will have to go through the battle. You will have to go through that pressure. And you will have to keep on focusing on what you have learned from the word. Praise God. And only those who go through the step number 1, 2, and 3, and 4 are the ones, he says, what's the fourth and fifth one? What does he say? If you do A, B, C, and D, he says, their life to those who find them. So by being attentive, inclining your ears, keeping them before your eyes, being watchful that you are not allowing it to be uprooted from your heart, you have now found that seed, and that seed is growing, and that seed will bring in the harvest. Praise God. And that's why he's saying, they are what? Life. The life that Jesus came to give you in abundance is in your heart. Hallelujah. And what's the next line? And their health? All my flesh. So if a person needs healing, physical, emotional, spiritual, or whatever kind of healing, might be in your finances, might be in your marriage, might be any area of your life, what that person needs is this four steps. Hallelujah. And when he goes through these four steps, praise God, the fifth one is the result. And then he gives you a clue when he says, listen, be watchful, be vigilant, be alert, be on your guard, for out of the heart flows what? Out of the heart flows what? Because please understand, whatever is in the heart will come out of your mouth. If fear is in your heart, it will come out of your mouth. If worry is in your heart, it will come out of your mouth. If the word of God is in your heart, it will come out of your mouth. Praise be to God. And then what's going to come out of your mouth, coming from the heart with confidence, is having so much of power that it activates the spiritual realm and brings it into manifestation. So for example, if your heart is loaded with corruptible seeds of worry and fear and anxiety and destruction and problems, and you speak it out of your mouth, it will still go and activate the spiritual realm and bring forth manifestation. So a seed coming out of your a seed planted in your heart when spoken out of your mouth releases a supernatural power in the spiritual realm that brings forth manifestation in the future in your life. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Put on the slide. And therefore, what are you supposed to do? You must guard your heart, because what flows out of your heart ultimately becomes your... Come on, ultimately becomes your... Ultimately becomes your life. Praise God. Now, very, very important is, many times people have been studying the word, meditating on the word, speaking the word, imagining the word, and doing all those things, and then they tend to give up. They give up because between the seed and the harvest, there is something called as time. Let's see what Jesus has to say about that. Again, a revision. Praise God. This time it's a revision. I believe it's helping you. Hello?
Yes.
Is it? Yes. Okay. Mark chapter 4, verse 26. I'm not going much in detail because we have already studied. I'm just giving you the revision, praise God, so that you build yourself up again. Mark 4:26. Now look what Jesus is saying. The kingdom of God is not yet come. Jesus said, so is the kingdom of God as if a man should cast a seed into the ground. Now that seed is, Jesus said, the seed is the word of God. A sower went and sowed the seed. The ground is the heart. Now, every one of us have been created out of the dust, because when God created Adam, he created him out of the dust. So in other words, our hearts are made of special dust created by God in such a way that when this spiritual seed is planted in your heart, this spiritual ground, which is a special dust created by God, never will discriminate between the seeds. In other words, if you plant the good seed or an evil seed, the heart does not decide whether to sprout it or not. No. The soil is created in such a way, whatever seed has been planted, it will make it sprout. Are you with me? That's very important. The heart or the soil does not discriminate between good seed and bad seed. It will make it sprout. Praise God. So the man went and cast the seed into the ground, and then what did he do? And should sleep. You know, this word is the key word. Say that, sleep. Tell your neighbor, sleep. No, you might be laughing, but when you understand what Jesus is saying, you will be saying, hey, I'm doing it exactly opposite to what Jesus is saying. He says, he should sleep. Say that, should sleep. Say that again. So what is Jesus demanding when the word of God has been cast into your heart?
For example, you are saying, I am the body of Christ and Satan has no power, no place in me. Now that's the seed that you planted in your heart. And then when you planted that seed in your heart, what do you need to do? You need to go and sleep. Praise God. That's what Jesus is saying. But he never said you should go to sleep with fear. He did not say you should go to sleep with what? How many of us, before going to sleep, go to sleep with what? Hello? Did Jesus say after you cast the seed into the ground, you should go to sleep with what? No. Which one do we follow? Now, if you go to sleep with why, then you have planted not the incorruptible seed, but you have planted the corruptible seed, and that's why you are worried. Praise God. He should go to sleep and rise night and day. He said, don't go to sleep forever. You got to get up in the morning. And when you get up in the morning, you are responsible to go and do your duties. Praise God. There are many of us who want to be farmers who only pray but never go to the field to plow or water. Hallelujah. There is something that you got to do. Say, listen, God wants us to have that abundant life. He has done his part, but we got to do our part as well. Praise God. Hallelujah. So he said, you got to plant the seed and then go to sleep, and then you got to rise. And the farmer, when he has planted the seed, the next day what will he do? He will go and what? Water the seed. How do you as a farmer water that incorruptible seed in your heart? Do you need watering? Yes. How will you water it? Very good. You should take a bottle of water and keep on drinking. Very good. And if you put some ice, praise be to God, it will not get burnt out in the sun. How do you water the seed? By thanksgiving. Why do you say that? Because Jesus himself said in Mark 11:24 that whatsoever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it and you shall have it. So first when you believe that you have received it, praise be to God, now you are saying, Lord, the seed that I planted, I have already by faith received the harvest of it, and you are watering the seed. Now when you say thank you Lord, 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 what are you doing? You are watering the seed. How many Christians do you find who are watering their seed? Praise God. Now, please understand, the farmer planted the seed and he began to water the seed and it is covered with soil. Can that farmer see the seed? No. So, when the seed has been planted and the watering process is going on, there is no motivation that comes to the person planting the seed. There's no motivation because there's no evidence of anything growing because it's all growing underneath and you can't see it. Praise God. Praise God. And that's when many Christians begin to quit. Because I want to see some evidence. But the Bible says that there will be no evidence. And that's why he says, the seed should spring and grow up, he knows not how. Many of us have got another thing to do is, when a seed has been planted, Lord, you said you will supply all my needs. Now tell me, Lord, how are you going to do it? He says, don't ask me how. You fix on the word will do everything for you. Praise God. You keep watering the seed. Hallelujah. So very, very important in the midst of that process that the person must develop patience. If you have impatience, then you will blow up the seed. Have you ever lost patience? How many years back? Hello? Hello? Please. He did not say sleep in the Bible class, okay? You please be awake. Praise God. Do you lose your patience? Yes. Now, whenever a patience is, when you begin to lose your patience and you become impatient, what's the cause of impatience? The cause of impatience is that you got now contaminated faith or negative faith. Because the Bible says when your faith is tested, it will develop, it will bring growth in your patience. But now when your faith is being tested and you get into worry and you get into fear or negative faith, now instead of patience getting developed, that patience will become impatient. Praise God. And when the person is impatient, now what do you think the person is speaking? Beautiful, loving, passionate, anointed words. Have you ever seen anybody impatient and opening his mouth? It's venom. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now what has that person done? Uprooted.